Hello and welcome to this global overview on electric buses. My name is Jean-Dominique Bonnet. I'm a consultant at Frost & Sullivan, and we look here at electric buses, meaning in that sense battery electric buses and fuel cell electric buses that run on hydrogen, not so much the kind of trolleybus that we have on this picture. So first, what we mean is that that mobility and buses operate in an ecosystem, and this ecosystem is affected by trends. Going clockwise here, we have first trend is the increased urbanization, which means that buses can contribute to a challenge of reducing the congestion in the cities. The second thing also is that buses can contribute to a lower footprint in terms of environment, and it's what we are discussing in terms of electric mobility. Electric mobility means that you can be zero emission at the bus level, maybe not completely on a full life cycle, because you might have greenhouse gases emissions during the production of a battery, and you have certainly also greenhouse gases emission in most cases at the time of production of electricity or even hydrogen. But already today, these solutions are more efficient than fossil fuels, in addition also to the elimination of pollutants such as the nitrogen oxide. The third element is that buses really work in synergy with other ways of transportation. That's the intermodality, in which you complement buses, for example, with rail or with micro-mobility, personal mobility, even crowdsource mobility. All these solutions, I'm at the fourth quadrant now, are connected for higher efficiency, which allow better use of the assets that you have in terms of disponibility, fast moving fast from one area to the other. And that drives also a lower cost of ownership. The cost of ownership that we have here is lower due to that higher efficiency of connected vehicle, also the fact that the energy when we are using electricity is cheaper than fossil fuel to a great extent today also because of a different taxation, but there is intrinsically also a component of higher efficiency, energy efficiency of electric buses. And last but not least also, that coincide with the introduction of new business models is a consequence to some extent of a higher cost of electric buses. We are looking at alternative way to be a little bit lighter on assets, and we'll touch on one of the models such as battery leasing. In terms of initiative that support the deployment of electric buses, we'll go now counterclockwise, starting with North America. We have elements such as the FAST Act that is now extended with the infrastructure bill and the low and no emission program, which provide $1.1 billion per year for electrification or no emission of buses in the US. There are similar programs also in Canada. In Europe, we have already a lot of restriction in terms of low emission zones, clean vehicle directives, and we have also the DRIVE program, which is a joint initiative for hydrogen vehicle across Europe. So we see here that in Europe, in addition to the BEV, there is a lot of emphasis also on fuel cell electric vehicle. Moving now to LATAM, we have a ZEBRA initiative that is designed for zero emission buses, rapid introduction accelerator, and that program is working principally in Mexico, Chile, Colombia, and Brazil. India goes for FEM, which is a faster adoption of manufacturing and hybrid and electric vehicles to lower also the footprint in terms of greenhouse gases. And finally, China has been working for a long time on electrification, so now they are still with programs such as the new energy vehicle subsidies and the fuel cell city program. A lot of emphasis on fuel cells in China. Moving now to a different kind of powertrain that are equipping these buses. So we are moving away from that left column, which is diesel. And already 10 to 15 years ago, we started moving to natural gas. Natural gas is a fossil fuel, which is lighter in carbon due to a structure of a molecule, which means that we can reduce about 20% the emissions of greenhouse gases with natural gas We have to control very seriously any leak of natural gas, because any 1 or 2% leak would void the benefit of lower emissions, since natural gas itself is a potent greenhouse gas, but it's a solution that has been used for the last 10 or 15 years. About 10 years ago also, we started working with hybrid and PHEV, plug-in hybrid electric vehicle. But now really the emphasis is on the BEV, the battery electric vehicle, and you see here, for example, that in China, it's very much what has been developed for the last 5 or maybe already 10 years. Moving now to some extent in different countries to complement with a fuel cell electric vehicle, which is strong in the US, a little bit less in Europe, and further less in North America, not so much in India or in Latin America. What is the architecture that supports these buses? Looking first at the battery electric vehicle, we can have a mixed architecture if a bus is derived from just removing, so to speak, the ICE engine and replacing with an electric motor. We have a conventional architecture in which we keep the carrier, the drive shaft and everything. Alternately, it can be already an integrated e-axle or a wheel hub in which the motor are integrated and are making just one piece. This motor can be of two different types. It can be either a synchronous motor with a permanent magnet design, which is very efficient in terms of energy but is costly. Alternately, we have the asynchronous motor, which is less expensive, but you have to compensate, so to speak, with a larger battery, since the efficiency, electric energy efficiency of this motor is not as good. The inverter is the device or piece that goes between the battery and the motors to control the power that is sent to the motors. The technology right now is mostly IGBT and moving to MOSFET. That's an important element also because there is some efficiency in that. And that device works in two ways. It will allow the transfer of energy from a battery to the motors, but symmetrically in terms of regenerative braking, the wheel will turn the motor, which in turn can recharge the battery, so you don't lose that much energy in braking as you would do with a traditional ICE, and it's one of the benefits of electrification. The power of these motors also, we can gain some agility on these buses. The electric motors are clearly less expensive than the thermal ICE, and therefore they are usually sized a little bit larger, which allows for better acceleration. The range, pretty much at this point for transit buses, we need something higher than 200 miles, and we'll see that a little bit later, but the energy consumption is that for a 12-meter bus, you need about 1.7 or 1.8 kilowatt hour per mile, and therefore to make that 250 miles to 300 miles, you need batteries that are in the magnitude of 440 to 660 kilowatt hour. Some buses have smaller battery to 20 and might need to be recharged on the go. Longer term, and that would be mostly for coaches, we will have also a range that can go to 400 or 550 miles, requiring larger battery of 700 or 800 kilowatt hour. In terms of chemistry of the batteries, initially most buses were using a LTO, a lithium titanium oxide battery, which lasts fairly long, can be charged fairly quickly, but are expensive and low power density. So most of that has been replaced now with NMC battery, which is lithium nickel manganese cobalt, which are very compact in terms of energy density but a little bit expensive, or in many cases it's a LFP, which is a lithium iron phosphate, and this is used to a great extent in China. Looking now at how it looks like for a fuel cell vehicle, you still have a part of the architecture that is common with an electric bus, because you need also the same motor, but the battery would be smaller. In fact, what we have is a fuel cell stack that will produce the energy. The stack is sized in order to deliver a little bit more than the average energy needed by the bus, and there is a battery that we don't mention here that serves as a buffer. So the way it works is that this fuel cell stack will run permanently, so to speak, and run a little bit at a higher level or rate than what is needed for immediate use of the bus. It will charge its battery, and in case of acceleration, when you need more power, you will draw some energy out of both the fuel cell stack and the battery. These kind of fuel cells are at this point proton exchange membrane PEM. There are other kind of fuel cells like solid oxide, which operate at higher temperature, that might be deployed in the future, but right now everything is PEM. In terms of energy storage, if you look at a kilogram of hydrogen, it has about the same energy content as a gallon of diesel, a little bit less, maybe 0.87 gallon of diesel, and therefore the consumption that you have would be such as you can do about 7 miles per kilogram of hydrogen, and therefore if you want that kind of range, 300 to 400 miles, you need to have a tank that will contain 35 to 60 kilograms of hydrogen. If you go with coaches for longer distance, it could be 40 to 80 kilograms. It's a lot of space, because if we look at the storage that we can have, under 700 bars, you just have 42 kilograms of hydrogen in 1 cubic meter, and therefore here these tanks would already be more than a cubic meter. If we go with 350 bars, it's even worse, so to speak. We just have 25 kilograms of hydrogen per cubic meter, and we need fairly large tanks. An alternative would be to have cryogenic hydrogen, which is cooled down at a very low temperature, and you can reach a density of about 80 kilograms of hydrogen per cubic meter, but you need a kind of a thermos bottle as far as tank. Now we are talking about the leasing model for batteries. It works with three different actors in that. First, the OEM will sell you or lease to you a bus, without an electric bus, without a battery. The benefit of that is that the cost that you will get is about the same cost of a diesel or natural gas bus. So you don't have an upfront payment that is higher than what you have usually. Then you have a lessor that will buy batteries and lease them to you under certain conditions, such as securing that you always have a battery in good shape. This battery also lasts only a certain number of cycles, something like 1500 cycles, which means that after 5 or 6 years, the battery will need to be replaced, which the lessor will do for you. The old battery can be either repurposed for energy storage or been recycled. And what the operator does is that he will basically pay a lease every month, and that lease, the theory is that the savings that you can get through the lower cost of energy, for example comparing the cost of diesel versus electricity, and with the addition of a lower cost of maintenance of electric buses compared to diesel buses, will allow you to pay the lease. So the net should be that you will in fact pay not much or even less in total than if you would be running a diesel bus. So that's a business for everybody, and in many cases that lessor of a battery can be the same as the OEM. Now, what does it mean in terms of total market? I might be hiding here China. China still is a big player in that. By 2030, we see new sales of buses, electric buses, about 150,000 in China per year, which means that it will be 73% of the global total. The second one in terms of sales would be Europe, with close to 25,000 buses, electric buses. Again, these buses are a mix of battery electric buses and fuel cell electric buses. The third one would be India, with 15,000 buses. Then Latin America with 11,000 buses, and last, North America with 7,000 buses. It doesn't mean that North America will be less electrified, it's just that the population of buses is much larger in Latin America than it is North America. In fact, in terms of proportion of electric buses to the total buses, China would be first, Europe would be second, North America would be third, India would be fourth, and Latin America is number five in that ranking. Looking finally at elements such as the total cost of ownership, meaning what it costs you on average between the purchase of a bus, the maintenance, the energy that we use, and the insurance in that case. Here we make a comparison between four types of powertrain: diesel, natural gas, battery electric, and fuel cell. Same vehicle all along in that comparison. It's a 12-meter transit bus equipped with an 8.9-liter engine, whether it's diesel or natural gas, which means that it might have something like 300 horsepower. In comparison to that, the battery electric vehicle would have 250 kilowatt motor, which is likely about 350 horsepower, so it's a little bit more, with a battery that will give a range of 250 miles per day. And the fuel cell would be fairly similar, maybe size a little bit lower, because right now everything is expensive in terms of fuel cell stack, the tank for hydrogen. This bus would be, in all cases, operated during 12 years, that's the standard, which corresponds pretty much to 500,000 miles, 12 times 40,000. The energy consumption is an important parameter in cost of a bus. The diesel bus would give us 4.4 miles per gallon, natural gas 3.7. The reason is that most natural gas engines are less efficient than engines that are run on diesel, and therefore there is a higher consumption. For a battery electric vehicle, we would need 1.7 or 1.8 kilowatt per mile. So the inverse, converting that in miles per kilowatt to be consistent here, is 0.57. And I'm hiding, I guess, here 7.3 miles per kilogram of hydrogen. When we put all these elements together and we look at the picture in 2020 and 2023, we see that looking at the bars on the left side each time, that the lower cost right now is with natural gas at a cost of $2.44 per mile with natural gas, followed by a diesel bus, electric bus, and the fuel cell bus. So why is that fuel cell bus so much penalized? At this point, it's because the cost of acquisition cost of a fuel cell bus today is fairly expensive. It's more expensive than a battery electric bus. The second element is that the cost of a fuel is currently also very high. We are at about $10 to $12 per kilogram of hydrogen, and that's very penalizing compared to the other solutions. Longer term, here we see, and we have maybe been not as optimistic as other people in terms of reduction, that cost of hydrogen fuel will certainly go down to the level of 7 to 5, or even some people are saying $3 per kilogram. So that will help the conjunction of lower cost of energy for the fuel cell bus, and the fact that the cost of the bus also will go down, which we see with that light blue, means that fuel cell bus will be becoming a little bit less expensive. But still, if we make a comparison longer term, that's the electric bus, which in 2030, 33 would be much less expensive to run than any solution that we have, with solution fairly at the same level between diesel and fuel cells. So again, a lot of assumption in that in terms of evolution, but we bake into that an evolution, a decrease in the cost of a battery, decrease in the cost of a fuel cell, decrease in the cost of a tank for hydrogen. The fact that you don't see a big decrease here is that we have let inflation run between the 2 years, the two different dates, so to speak, and 13 years of inflation pretty much offset the benefit that you get through reduction of cost of a battery and different elements. So that's fairly much the picture. We see a lot of potential and future, obviously, for battery electric buses, and to some extent also a fuel cell buses have different benefit, and it will be very much linked also to the kind of infrastructure and energy supply that each country will select. So there is not a clear winner, so to speak. Each has some benefit, and I think we really need a mix of both. So if you want some more information, we'll be glad to let you connect with us. Here you have our contact information, and well, thank you, and good luck in your learning. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.